See further back in time than ever before. Now, the question must be asked.
Are we alone?
One of the greatest questions facing the history of the human race.
Open your mind to the impossible.
They're here.
Who?
I'm sure it's not human.
Or what?
They are not ours.
He's in our skies.
They're all over the world.
Hello and welcome to Spotlight. Tonight, it is the biggest mystery in the universe, and these stunning developments are just minutes away.
Oh my gosh, man.
Incredible new videos.
This is weird.
It happens multiple times a week.
Alien technology.
I want to understand what they're doing.
Washington's biggest secret.
Congress is holding its first hearing on UFOs in more than 50 years.
Unidentified aircraft.
A potential national security threat.
They could wipe us off the map like that.
And have we attempted to communicate with those objects?
No. I'm not allowed to talk about that.
A major political cover-up.
Is the United States hiding something? Of course.
We are absolutely committed to being as transparent as we can.
We don't understand.
You're the guys investigating it.
We are committed to a focused effort to determine their origins.
Stop hiding it.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the NSA.
Something is out there.
Wow.
That's pretty intriguing.
We do not have an explanation.
This exists, and it's not from here.
A Ross Coulthard investigation.
A ball of light had a beard.
We've got something.
Mind-blowing stuff.
It's moving.
It scared the shit out of me.
That's out of this world.
I mean, it's a game changer.
Open your mind.
Joining me again is investigative reporter Ross Coulthard. Ross, you've just returned from the US where this UFO story, it's pretty fair to say, it is really heating up.
It's huge. At the moment, the Congress is visibly angry with the people in the Pentagon and the intelligence community who haven't responded quickly enough, they believe, to their requests for information about what they know about UAPs, unidentified aerial phenomena. So they're demanding more information and they're not going to let go.
For too long, the stigma associated with UAPs has gotten in the way of good intelligence analysis. Unidentified aerial phenomena are a potential national security threat.
Oh, what in the world is this?
Oh my gosh, what is that?
I do not have an explanation for what this specific object is.
An object apparently changing shapes in seconds.
What?
Oh my gosh, dude.
Look, nothing in the sky at all. And then all of a sudden, bam, what is that? We're in the middle of the ocean.
One of the things most people don't realize is just how often UAPs are being seen. This is one taken by a pilot over Colombia en route to Mexico City. It's a video of what looks like a kind of a cube-shaped object coming towards the aircraft, apparently at high speed. Now, some debunkers might suggest it's a balloon, but these are the things that now need to be investigated, and indeed a lot of these bits of evidence are coming forward.
What we're seeing is quite extraordinary.
It is extraordinary, and in fact, this is a video that explains one of the reasons why we went back to the United States to investigate what's happening now.
The hallowed campus of Stanford University, San Francisco. Among its alumni, 20 Nobel Prize laureates, two US presidents, and now home to one of the world's foremost immunologists, Professor Gary Nolan. A man convinced that his own government has been hiding the biggest secret of all time.
So how significant is it that the US government has actually admitted that whatever they are, unidentified aerial phenomena, are real?
I think it tells us that, first of all, the government has been lying to us for the last 60 or 70 years. I think it's a sea change in, frankly, our understanding of the universe. And it is a sea change on the part of the government to come out and say that this phenomenon is real. I think it gives solace to people who have been told that they were crazy to have been believing or seeing this.
I know this is speculative, but why do you think the US government's lied?
I think it's because, frankly, they didn't understand what it was, and nobody wanted to admit that, first of all. But second, they didn't want to admit that they didn't have control over our airspace. We didn't have control over our own airspace.
So the government's been lying, but do you think there's been a cover-up?
Absolutely. I mean, there has been both a cover-up as well as a disinformation campaign to make people look like they were crazy.
The history of this is that back in the 1950s and the 1960s and the 1970s, there was a government snow job to shut down public interest in the phenomenon of UFOs, flying saucers, UAPs, whatever you call them. We now know for a fact, because documents have been released confirming this, that there was a government cover-up. There was a deliberate attempt at disinformation. See, this is amazing to me to hear a scientist of your reputation saying this. I mean, you're one of the most eminent immunologists on the planet. You're a Nobel Prize nominee. You're somebody highly respected in your area of medicine. Is it a dangerous thing for you to admit that you think these things about the phenomenon?
I think it's dangerously necessary. I think that this is the kind of thing that if we continue to ignore it, if we continue to ignore the potential danger of what it might represent, we are putting ourselves at risk both to what it might do to us in sometime in the future, but then ignoring the physics of what these things are capable of doing.
They are the sights and sounds that shocked the world. UFOs caught on camera, not by an anonymous citizen with a Polaroid, but the equipment of the most sophisticated Navy in the world. Their titles are now UFO folklore. The Tic Tac. The Go Fast. And the Gimbal.
The great thing about these videos is they were supported by multiple sensor systems.
Oh my gosh, dude.
They weren't just seen on video. They were seen by human eyeballs. They were seen by radar. They were tracked on forward-looking infrared. Multiple different sensor systems verified that these were objects doing things that are not capable of being done within known human physics.
Be like these cat and mouse chases where the plane will go up and then the object will go up and meet the plane at a certain level. There's a case in Iran, a case in Peru where that happened. Then the Tic Tac ended up at the cap point, the meeting point in the air where the planes were going. There's obviously some kind of intelligence there. I mean, they're responsive, they're interactive with aircraft.
Perhaps the most intriguing case, I think it's fair to say, happened above the USS Nimitz. That was in 2004. What sets that case apart?
The USS Nimitz case was a cracker because dozens of these objects moved instantaneously from above 80,000 feet to, in one case, just above the surface of the ocean in 0.78 of a second. Those are speeds that are just way beyond known human technology. The best radar systems on the planet tracked these objects doing these speeds. It provided irrefutable evidence that can no longer be denied that there is something being operated by someone or something that is beyond known human science. And it happened just off the coast of California. A phenomenon has been seen off that coastline now for years. The area we were sailing in is ground zero for UAP sightings.
On board, I'm joined by Bryce Zabel, former chairman of the Emmy Awards and the producer of the acclaimed UFO series Dark Skies, and Ben Hansen, a Discovery Channel host who formerly worked for the FBI.
If you were able to watch the congressional hearings,
right,
you would get the sense that we only have the tip of the iceberg. And what they're willing to share with us, this stuff's been going on for quite some time, even before, you know, they had an official task force to investigate it.
More recently, they've become dedicated UFO investigators with a keen eye on this stretch of water.
There's a plane out there. There you go. Look at that. Actually, that thing has been sitting out there in the same place for quite some time.
Ben was using top-of-the-line night vision equipment, which is actually forbidden for export from the United States. It allows you to intensify illuminated objects brightly.
If you look at a map and you look at the sightings that take place in the United States, by far the majority happen around large bodies of water.
The sightings have been recorded not just over Californian waters, but across the continent, over the Atlantic coast, where in 2014, former Navy pilot Ryan Graves' squadron were first-hand witnesses to unidentified aerial phenomena.
It all kind of came to a head when someone in my squadron, they almost hit this object, and they never had it on their radar. When he came back, he described it with his mouth open. He said, "I almost hit one of those damn things." And then he described it as a dark gray or black cube that was inside a translucent or clear sphere. So what's interesting about these objects is that they cross the boundaries of what normal aircraft are designed for.
These objects could do instantaneous speeds. They could go from naught to 10,000 miles an hour in a blink of an eye.
If I were the Air Force and I saw something like this, I would want to drive one of them.
You explain to me, sir, as a scientist, if a country could master the technology that lies behind this phenomenon, mm-hmm, how important is that technology?
Well, it's a game changer. So if you're asking questions, why might the U.S. government want to limit knowledge of this, they might have a perfectly good reason for doing so, and that's it. That they realize that it's dangerous to play with this.
The recent pressure by Congress on the military has forced the military to own up to the fact that it's sitting on hours of videotapes of something that is up there in the sky. Open your mind to the possibility that they could be thousands, millions of years more advanced than us. Then new forms of technology begin to open up. We're not talking about the very edge of our understanding of the quantum theory and general relativity. At that point, new phenomena start to enter into the picture, phenomena that allow you to exceed the speed of light.
What an incredible experience to meet such an incredibly brilliant man as Michio Kaku. He's a professor at New York University, but one of the fathers of the theoretical physics concept called string theory. Mind-blowing stuff. He acknowledges the reality of the phenomenon in a way that very few scientists are prepared to do publicly.
One military official was quoted as saying, quote, "They are not ours." And if they're not ours, then whose are they? If they're not the Chinese, if they're not the Russians, if they're not us, then what's left?
Could it be ET?
So we're left with the possibility now, and the military is now owning up to this, that they could be extraterrestrial. It would be a pivotal event in the history of Homo sapiens on the planet Earth. The realization that we are not alone. And then, of course, we have to begin the process of analyzing the question, who are these people? What do they want? How can we relate to these people? These are cosmic questions. And so this is perhaps one of the greatest questions facing the history of the human race. What happens if we make an encounter?
There are a number of events in which we do not have an explanation. There are flight characteristics or signature management.
that we can't explain with the data that we have.
In the hearing, I believe they said we had 14 near misses. Why is that not a headline? Why are people not asking more questions about what the heck is going on?
The United States Congress is now demanding answers on unidentified aerial phenomena. We've come here today to speak to one politician who's prepared to say he thinks it's a cover-up.
A good lawyer one time told me the truth is the best defense, and dadgummit, that's the truth. The cover-up is real. I'll just say I've been briefed by people who are in the know. And it's very telling what they're telling me. And they're, you know, I've talked to Navy pilots, have absolutely nothing to gain by telling me information. You know, they showed me photographs of things that were very unusual. And in fact, there's something in our airspace that we do not control, and that ought to be very concerning.
Shortly after our interview, the congressman showed me in confidence the photographs he was talking about. If authentic, they're extraordinary. They are very clear Polaroid images of a hovering, metallic flying saucer.
Looking at all these videotapes, okay, I've come to two conclusions. One conclusion is you have to be very careful. Some of these sightings are optical illusions, so you have to eliminate them very carefully. The other possibility is they are not ours, that they represent a technology that is hundreds, thousands of years more advanced than us. And if they can go between stars, it means they're up to maybe a million years more advanced than us.
Do you think the United States knows a lot more than it's letting on?
The question is the United States hiding something? Well, of course.
Next.
The United States government is in possession of alien technology.
I know it for a fact. I mean, I just know that.
Why do you know that?
Because I've spoken to the people who are about to come out and whistleblow on it.
Before you leave office, will you let us know if there's aliens?
No. An alien spacecraft did not crash in Roswell, New Mexico in 1947.
So there has been a cover-up.
Oh, yes.
Let's talk about the White House. What does the President of the United States know about UFOs or UAPs?
That's a great question, Michael. I actually wrote a letter to Hillary and Bill Clinton a couple of weeks ago. I haven't got an answer back. But what we do know, of course, is that this has been the stuff of myth for years. It goes right back to 1947, where allegedly a UFO, a flying saucer, crashed at a place called Roswell in New Mexico. And of course, for years, for decades, there's been mysterious stories about alleged flying saucers, discs being kept in secret by the US government at the Nevada Test Range, better known as Area 51. The simple fact is, the presidents probably aren't told the full story. That's what I've been told by people on the inside. Presidents only get told if they need to be told.
I got a letter from 13-year-old Ryan from Belfast. Now, Ryan, if you're out in the crowd tonight, here's the answer to your question. No. As far as I know, an alien spacecraft did not crash in Roswell, New Mexico in 1947. And Ryan, if the United States Air Force did recover alien bodies, they didn't tell me about it either. And I want to know.
Will you let us know if there's aliens?
Would you ever open up Roswell and let us know what's really going on there?
So many people ask me that question.
I know, it sounds almost ridiculous, but it's actually the real question.
It sounds like a cute question, but it's actually, there are millions and millions of people that want to go there, that want to see it. I won't talk to you about what I know about it, but it's very interesting. But Roswell's a very interesting place with a lot of people that would like to know what's going on.
Has now cleared the way for people to come forward
who want to come forward to give evidence about secret UFO programs. And let's be clear, there are people who have alleged that the United States government is concealing a reverse engineering program where they are trying to back engineer recovered non-human, yes, alien technology. Alien spacecraft that have been recovered secretly by the US in the period since the Second World War, which they've been sitting on for decades. Yes, I believe the United States government is in possession of alien technology. I'll say that again, alien technology. The former head of the Pentagon's UFO investigation program, Luis Elizondo, he said publicly that he thinks the US government is in possession of exotic material. Other people have been more candid. Other insiders have suggested that the United States is in possession of craft, non-human technology.
Right.
What do you think?
I think we've got some craft somewhere. I think that they, I've talked to too many people that have seen and held this so-called foreign material. And I don't think it's a Chinese technology. I don't think it's a Russian technology. Russian technology with Putin's ego, he landed adgum UFO on the front steps of the White House, get out and ride a unicorn bare-chested and wrestle Joe Biden and get back in it and head back to Mother Russia. And China would own us. So I think that's out of the question. I think that I think there's something we are trying to reverse engineer, but the problem is it's so advanced they can't reverse engineer it to the point of where they could actually build this craft.
There's a whole fleet of them. Look on the NSA. My gosh. Well, if there's a thing, it's rotating.
When you say the government's been involved in a cover-up, do you think they've been concealing?
Oh, yes.
It's an amazing allegation.
I know it for a fact. I mean, I just know that.
Why do you know that?
Because I've spoken to the people who are about to come out and whistleblow on it.
Wow. So you know what's coming?
Yeah.
So there has been a cover-up?
Yeah. And there has been an active cover-up. I mean, just look at what the Department of Defense announced last week. They announced an office to study the phenomenon. Money. Put aside. They've said, we're going to go back to 1947.
Which is incredible. That's the date of Roswell.
Yeah. 1947, we want a list of every operation that you've done to disinform and misinform.
We just had something go right over the top of us that, I hate to say this, looked like a long cylindrical object.
I think the probability that we have a captured flying saucer someplace at Area 51 or whatever is very, very small. But let's assume for the moment that it's true. Let's assume that we do have alien bodies, alien technologies, and so on and so forth. Would we keep it a secret? Of course. We're not stupid. I mean, you don't want to blab to the whole universe all the secrets that you can get from a damaged flying saucer.
Now, the thing I find fascinating is you've had the CIA come knocking on your door asking you to actually do tests on people who have been exposed to UAPs, correct?
Yes.
What can you tell me about that?
Well, the reason apparently that they came to me is because we had developed instrumentation for blood analysis that nobody else in the world had.
Have you been able to determine if any of these people have suffered injuries?
In some cases, not the pilots especially, but for some of the ground personnel, we were able to see damage in their brain tissue that was considerable.
So this is injuries suffered by people, and is it directly attributable to the UFOs, the UAPs?
They claim it. I am relaying what it is that was told to me. The confirmatory evidence that I have are the MRIs that basically show that anybody could look at repeatedly and see that there was damage.
And when you say damage, what sort of damage?
You would call it a sclerosis. It would be seen as a scar tissue in the body or the brain, dead tissue.
So it comes out as white blob.
We generally call it white matter disease.
After the break, the extraordinary claims of a man who may have alien technology in his backyard and why the experts are very interested in what he has in his possession.
I've had this thing for over 40 years. It's a part of me now. Sometimes I feel like it's protected me.
You think that's alien technology, don't you?
Yes, I do. I absolutely do.
That's a huge claim.
I believe it has to do with my connection with the aliens. That's the reason I have it. I think they wanted me to have it.
Our story brings us to Texas. I'm on my way to meet an extraordinary man with an even more incredible story. All I have is a grid reference. All will be explained.
I've had this thing for over 40 years. It's a part of me now. I've taken it with me everywhere I go, and I can't explain that.
You reckon it's been looking after you, don't you?
Sometimes I feel like it's protected me.
We've all seen those underwhelming images of UFOs, the distant, blurry images where you can't see much at all. So we've come here to Texas, we're not allowed to say where exactly, to meet a gent who tells us he may well have solid, testable evidence of alien technology. And it's been part of his family's furniture here for over 40 years. Enter Jim Marlin. Jim Marlin is claiming that he's got alien technology.
Wow.
But he's also been an incredibly successful music promoter.
On the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again.
He's the guy who launched Willie Nelson's music career as an outdoor performer.
I can't wait to get on the road again.
He's gone all over America doing multi-million dollar concerts, and he made a lot of money out of it. And the funny thing is that all through that career, he took this silver ball with him, this silver sphere.
And this is Dennis Hopper, the movie star. He was one of my absolute best friends. And then that's me.
Very famous actors from a multitude of different Hollywood movies, performers, singers, songwriters.
That's Neil Young.
Jane Fonda. They've all touched this sphere.
I was living in New Mexico, and a friend of mine, Dennis Hopper's bodyguard, wanted me to come out and see his house. It was way out in the desert, in the middle of nowhere. We went out there, and there was a pile of these spheres laying in his yard.
How many?
Maybe six or seven. I don't remember exactly. There was just a pile of them. And I was amazed, because I'd never seen anything like these. And I thought, what the heck is that? And he said, I'd tell you, but you wouldn't believe me. And I said, well, try me. And he said, well, Jim, I swear to God, a UFO came over my house and dropped these out in my yard. And he said, they've been sitting there ever since. And I was amazed at him, and he said, you want one, you can have one. So I took it. Well, I've had it for over 40 years, so I've seen it do some things that I can't explain. I was laying on my back on my floor, and I was just mindlessly rubbing my feet on the sphere while I was talking to a friend of mine. And when there suddenly there was this flash of light, and I was shot across the floor on my back. I was 6 to 10 feet away from the sphere. It knocked me that far away from it. You know, and there's no explanation for that.
You think that's alien technology, don't you?
Yes, I do. I absolutely do.
That's a huge claim.
I can't imagine what else it is. I just can't imagine why something like this moves around, why it would flash light. But I have since seen videos on the internet of spheres just like this one flying in the air, doing all kinds of things. And apparently they're all over the world.
There's a long history in UFO sightings of, as well as the lenticular disc shape that's often seen in classic UFO sightings. In a lot of sightings, and these have been tracked by a British guy called Patrick Jackson, there are these metallic silvery spheres seen adjacent to these objects. And so Patrick developed a theory that these spheres are some kind of protection mechanism, that they're stopping bad guys from entering Earth's atmosphere. In the 1970s, a family called the Betts family, they discovered in a forest a silver metallic sphere, very similar to the one that Jim has. And that sphere demonstrated apparent movement, spontaneous movement. When it was investigated, though, it was poo-pooed.
Now, the most prominent explanation for the Betts sphere's movement is that the ball was simply responding to uneven flooring in the Betts family home. It was found to be near perfectly weighted, so that even the smallest deviation might have caused it to roll.
I have seen the videos that you've seen of this ball spontaneously rolling around the floor. And Jim has apparently had this for 40 years. Propulsion inside might we use to conventionally explain it.
Now, I get the impression the Betts family, the family in Florida, they never got an answer, really, as to what their sphere was. It was never resolved.
They wanted to know as bad as I did what it was, and they got no answer. In fact, they got it taken away from them, is what happened to them.
So I'm just going to turn the camera around because this is a very nice gentleman here. This is Jim.
Hi, Jim. Nice to meet you.
So the fact that a scientist of the great reputation of Professor Gary Nolan is at least prepared to consider the possibility that there might be a non-human explanation for the technology that Jim has in his possession is mind-blowing.
This is a 50-pound sphere that is unbelievably heavy. It's not doing anything at the moment. But Jim tells us that he's seen it move across the room. It would be good if you could get some rust or anything on the surface.
If it's okay with you, we might scrape some of the rust off.
You bet.
One of the things that Professor Gary Nolan told me to do was to take samples of corrosion that we could see on the side of the silver sphere, because he said that might help him and his researchers figure out what the metals are that the sphere is made of. We need to weigh it. 50 pounds, 50 pounds exactly. I find that very strange, exactly 50 pounds.
Me too.
If you hold it on there for me, mate.
32 inches, 81 centimetres.
I've got a magnet here.
Magnetic.
It's moving.
If this is really alien technology with the ability of anti-gravity, you know, our civilization needs this. And I think it should fall into the right hands.
With the sample secured, we travel nearly 3,000 kilometers west to San Francisco, to the laboratory of Stanford University's immunology professor, Gary Nolan, where a machine awaits with the ability to test the origin of the metal that makes up Jim's mysterious sphere.
So this is a form of a secondary ion mass spectrometer. We call it MIBI, multiplexed ion beam imaging.
So you fire ions at a sample.
Right.
And it can tell you what's in that sample.
Right.
So what I've got here, as you advised, I got scrapings off Jim's ball, the sphere. Right. And these are the corrosion shavings.
Okay.
We've wrapped them
Great.
In paper. I couldn't get a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But is this the machine you'd put them through?
Oh, yeah. And we only would be reading off like 50 nanometers of material,
okay.
which is
well,
what's so great about this.
You've definitely got that. If there is something anomalous about the sphere, mm-hmm. if the sphere is alien, you can see that.
Right.
You'll let us know if there's anything anomalous.
Yes, it'll probably take me about a month.
It's possibly the tip of a huge discovery, if what Jim's saying is true.
If what is true, then you've got basically a UFO scout vehicle sitting in his house in Texas.
The sphere's now in the care of Professor Gary Nolan. And when we get those results, we'll be telling you what we know.
Coming up...
Three creatures came through the wall and came into my room. I screamed bloody murder. And my parents came running into the room, and I told them what happened.
If you have ever been kidnapped by an alien from outer space, for God's sake, steal something. Because afterwards you can say, aha, look, 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 proof, proof.
There's no history of psychosis in your family?
No, no.
Have you ever had hallucinations before?
Sure, on LSD and psychedelic mushrooms, sure, back when I was younger.
There are people all over the world who are saying they've had, well, contact. Often in their bedroom. You're not just a believer, you say you know it, don't you?
Absolutely, I do.
You're an experiencer, an abductee.
Yes, I am.
The reason why Jim Marlin's story is important is because there is a cohort of people across the world who claim experiences, including abductions, by aliens. So, Jim, let's talk about you when you were a little boy. What's your earliest experience of the phenomena?
Well, when I was probably third grade, I think that's when it started. I could lay in my bedroom, in my bed, just looking right out the window, when suddenly three creatures came through the wall and came into my room, and I couldn't move. I was paralyzed. I couldn't make a sound. I wanted to scream. I could not. They floated me up out of the bed and back into the kitchen and right through the wall. I can't remember anything after I went through the wall.
So what you're describing to me there is something I've heard from many, many people. It's the abduction experience. And I don't know what to make of that because I wasn't there. I didn't see it happen. What would you say about that to people who might challenge the reality of what you experienced?
Oh, it was a very real experience, and they brought me back through the wall. And as soon as they went through the wall, I could move, I could scream, and I did. I screamed bloody murder. And my parents came running into the room, and I told them what happened.
How much of your position on the phenomenon has been informed by your own personal experience?
I mean, so I did see an object very close up when I was a kid. I didn't know what it was. It just was a kind of roundish object with, I remember, kind of like four or five whitish lights pointing down. And, you know, I think, I can't even remember how old I was, 10 or 12, whatever.
Were you scared?
Whatever it was. No. I wasn't scared because I didn't know what it was.
it made you think.
It made me think. I mean, and, you know, I think being a scientist is all about being willing to ask the difficult question.
I get a lot of emails from people that have claimed that you're barking up the wrong tree. The aliens are not there. The aliens are here. They visited us. They're here. And I say, what proof do you have that the aliens are here? And they tell me that they've been abducted. They've been kidnapped by aliens in outer space. Well, I have a word of advice. If you have ever been kidnapped by an alien from outer space, for God's sake, steal something. I don't care whether it's a paperclip, an alien pen, an alien calculator. Steal something. Because afterwards you can say, aha, look, 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 proof, proof.
You want to see the evidence.
I'm a physicist. We live and die by the evidence.
When it comes to evidence, nothing beats a good witness.
Damien Knott, take one.
Ross, you've interviewed many fascinating witnesses as part of your investigation, including
Absolutely,
the gentleman
Mike.
Now.
Absolutely. This is Damien Knott. Damien's probably one of Australia's foremost unidentified aerial phenomena researchers. And some of the images you've obtained, the videos, the photographs, they're quite extraordinary. But there's one incident I really want you to talk about today, which is 3 years ago, you had a very harrowing incident in your front yard. Tell me what happened.
Well, 3 years ago, I was working on a documentary, and a UFO documentary, of course. And I was getting a bit tired, you know, it was getting late at night. And I went outside, I looked up to the sky, and just above the tree, to the left of the tree outside my home, it was about maybe 10 feet away, and a ball of light had appeared, and it was a purplish blue ball of light out of nowhere, maybe no bigger than a basketball. It was there and it was gone. Wow, what did I just see?
And were you aware of any physical symptoms that you were suffering as a result of exposure to that light?
I wasn't until a few days later.
What happened?
Initially it started as burns, like a sunburn on my arm. Like a regular sunburn, but not one that you could touch, like if you were burnt by the sun and you could touch it, was a bit sore. This thing, you couldn't feel it. And it got worse, it turned into blisters over a period of about a week and a half to 2 weeks.
They're harrowing photographs. And I know a lot of people watching this might be thinking, this is silly, you know, how can an object like a light ball,
a little ball of light,
cause, how can it cause injuries like that?
Yeah.
But as I understand it, it's now being taken very seriously by, of all places, Harvard University. There's a study that's being done. Tell me what they've said to you.
It could be an out-of-world radiation.
They actually told you that?
Some sort of exotic exposure, whatever that means.
This is the interesting thing, Mike, that Damien's not the only guy that suffered these kind of injuries. There are CIA agents, military officials, pilots of military aircraft in the United States. Whatever these objects are, they appear to be inducing very harrowing symptoms in people like Damien.
And this is radiation we're talking about?
Some type of radiation. They can't explain what it is. But the study they came out with, there's 100 or so people in the aerospace industry, Navy pilots, others who had these same lights come up to them while they're in the sky or wherever, and given them the same burns. Well, apparently one third of them are dead now.
The obvious question, what is this, Damien?
I wish I had the answer. I really do. I'd love to say they're aliens from another planet. I really don't know. I think the phenomenon is stranger than that, much stranger. A lot stranger than what people will ever think.
Look, we could talk for hours about this.
Oh, absolutely.
We don't have hours.
Absolutely, yeah.
Damien, thank you.
Oh, you're more than welcome. Thanks for having me on the show, guys. Yeah. I appreciate that. And lovely talking to you guys, you know.
Right. We'll have more of our investigation right after the break.
Thank you.
Ross, another night of big revelations. A big question for you then. Are we alone? Have we been visited already by aliens?
Well, it's a distinct possibility, Michael, because very senior intelligence officials in the United States, the Director of National Intelligence for the United States, indeed, former CIA directors, people in the Pentagon, the intelligence community, have said quite openly that a plausible explanation for what we're now witnessing and what the US military is now tracking and recording is that this is possibly a non-human intelligence. We may be talking some kind of alien entity.
You've spoken to many witnesses. Let's give the final word to them.
Is there anybody out there?
Why do you think there is such hostility to the idea of investigating the possibility of non-human intelligent life?
Well, that would put us not at the top of the food chain, first of all. And from a religious point of view, it's a context clash that, okay, well, if these things exist and they're there, where do they fit in the hierarchy to angels and God?
I go out every night and I look at the stars, and some of those stars, the actual light from those stars left that star before the time of Christ. I mean, that's mind-boggling to me. And to think that in the vastness of God's creation that we are the best he can do, I just don't buy that.
When you look at pictures from the Webb Space Telescope and the Hubble Space Telescope, realize that many of these pictures are just one little pinpoint. That little dot is a galaxy. That's 100 billion stars in each dot. And how many dots are there in that pinpoint? Billions. What we're talking about is a photograph of trillions, trillions of stars. Think about that for a moment. The probability that we're the only game in town is a fraction, the inverse of trillions. And so you begin to realize that, of course, they're out there. Of course. Why should we be special?
Jim, what do you think UFOs, unidentified aerial phenomena, are?
I think they're from a civilization that is way beyond us. They have technologies that are so far beyond us.
My God.
Whatever it is, it's been here a long time. So, and certainly it's been here longer than we've been civilized. So, at the very least, who really owns the planet? Who was here first? I'm not sure it was us.
If it does turn out that we have been visited and it could be proven by an advanced civilization, then that would be the greatest moment in the history of the human race. It would be a pivotal event in the history of Homo sapiens on the planet Earth. The realization that we are not alone.
Is there anybody out there? Is there anybody out there?